Welcome back, linguists. Today I'd like to talk to you about phonetics, the science behind the sounds that make up the words that make up the sentences that make up the languages of the world. So by and large, we can classify the sounds of a language into two major classes, consonants and vowels. So overall, there are somewhere between 35 and 45 different sounds in the English language. That is well more than the 26 letters we have to represent sounds in English writing. Therefore, we need a special system. That system is called the International Phonetic Alphabet, where each individual symbol represents a single sound. The International Phonetic Alphabet incorporates characters not only from the Roman alphabet, but also from the Greek alphabet and other typographies as well. Furthermore, in order to make all of these different sounds have some kind of organizing principle in the International Phonetic Alphabet, in order to arrange them in some kind of system, like you do with a periodic table of elements in chemistry, you can rely on how you describe the articulators, the things that produce those sounds in the human body. The articulators are the lungs, throat, vocal folds, lips, tongue, and nose. And if you arrange all these things into a chart, you get three major ways of describing sounds. Those are the place of articulation, the manner of articulation, and the voicing of the sound. So, starting off, the first column that you have on the IPA chart are the bilabial sounds. Bilabial sounds are sounds that are made with both of the lips. Bi means two, labial, lips. So the bilabial sounds in English are b, as in boy, p, as in pirate, m, as in mother, and w, as in whale. Next, going one back, you have labiodental sounds. Labiodental sounds are made with the bottom lip touching the top teeth. In English, we have two labiodental sounds. V, as in vat of chemicals, and f, as in fat. Next, we have the interdental sounds. Interdental sounds are made with the tongue either at or just poking between the two sets of teeth. So, for example, in English, we have th, as in thin, and th, as in this. Those are the two interdental sounds that we have in English. Next, we have the alveolar sounds. Those are sounds that are made with your tongue touching your alveolar ridge. If you stick your finger inside your mouth and first feel the back of your front teeth, and then feel that thing just behind that, that's your alveolar ridge. It should feel hard and it should be kind of wrinkly. The alveolar sounds in English are t, as in top, d, as in dog, s, as in snake, z, as in zebra, l, as in light switch, and r, as in really. Just beyond the alveolar ridge, we have what are called the post-alveolar sounds. Those are sounds that are made just a little bit further back. The tip of your tongue is touching not that ridge, but just behind it. You can think of that as maybe the roof of your mouth. The post-alveolar sounds that we have in English are sh, as in shoot, zh, as in measure, ch, as in church, and j, as in judge. Then moving slightly further back in your mouth again, we have the palatal sounds. The palatal sounds are those sounds made touching that smooth part of the hard palate, definitely now at the roof of your mouth. The only palatal sound that we really have in English is y, as in yes, yes. Going just behind the hard palate to the soft part, that's your velum, and sounds made at that part of your mouth are called the velar sounds. English has four velar sounds. K, as in kill. G, as in gill. W, as in will, my last will and testament. And then finally a sound that never occurs at the beginning of a word, but you're already very familiar with it because it occurs at the end of a lot of your verbs, and that's ng, as in running, or as in walking. It's usually spelled with an ng in English. No. A lot of languages can make that sound at the beginning of a word, but not English. English can only make that sound at the end of a word. Finally, English has something called a glottal stop. That's a sound made in your glottis. A glottal stop is that catch in your throat in the middle of a word like Some people classify H as being a glottal sound as well, but I would prefer to say that H is a placeless sound. It occurs in English as a consonant that doesn't really occur anywhere. You can make an H anywhere in your mouth. So those are the different places of articulation in English, and places of articulation correspond to the different columns in the IPA chart. Next we have manners of articulation, and manners of articulation correspond to the different rows in the IPA chart. The first row, or the first manner of articulation that we need to know about, are stops. Stops come in two flavors, oral and nasal. Stops are basically when you completely stop the sound coming out of your mouth. So if you make a sound like puh, pirate, or apple, that P sound completely stops all of the sound coming out of your throat, therefore it's called an oral stop. The M is the corresponding nasal stop. So if you make a P, but then let the air come out your nose instead of your mouth, it's going to sound like an M. That should work, hopefully for you at home. The next row down from stops are the fricatives. Fricatives are sounds that are produced by creating turbulence in the airstream coming out of your lungs. So, those are all fricative sounds. That last one really isn't a sound in English, but it occurs in a lot of the world's languages, including German. Fricative sounds create turbulence. They create frication. Next, we have two manners of articulation that do not occur on the IPA chart. These are called affricates. They're combinations of both stops and fricatives. English has two affricate sounds, ch as in church and j as in judge. So, if you think about the ch in church, it's kind of like you're saying a t followed immediately by a sh. Ch. 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 And that's how an affricate works. Next, we have a set of sounds also not on the IPA chart called rhotics. Rhotics are R-like sounds in the world of languages. And rhotics vary a lot from one language to another. The only similarity that they seem to have is that speakers of one language will substitute their rhotic for whatever language they're learning. So when I'm learning French, which has a r rhotic sound, there's a good chance I'll substitute my English rhotic sound, r, and say something silly like rouge. That happens a lot, right? But so rhotics are R-like sounds, and English only has one of them, r. Next we have the liquid sounds. Liquid sounds are things that are kind of midway between being consonants and vowels. That is, liquid sounds don't really block the airflow as strongly as regular consonants do. They leave it more open, like vowels do. The two liquids that we have in English are r and l, that is, l and r. Finally, we have two glides in English, w and y. A lot like liquids, glides are also these sounds that are really, phonetically speaking, closer to being vowels than they are to being consonants. And the fact that we call them consonants rather than vowels actually has something to do with phonology rather than phonetics, which we'll talk about in a different video. But, so the two glides in English are wa, as in would, and ya, as in you. Finally, the last way we can talk about consonant sounds is whether or not they are voiced. When a sound is voiced, it means that you're producing it with your vocal folds vibrating, and it's something you can actually feel. So, if you put your hand right here on your throat, and say the F sound, you shouldn't feel anything going on in your throat. That's because F is voiceless. Now if you do it again, and instead of F you make the V sound, you should feel a humming there. And that's because the V is voiced. And honestly, the only difference between F and V is that V is voiced, whereas F is not. And you can switch back and forth between the two sounds just by turning on and off your vocal folds. So, and so when you look at the cells in the IPA chart, whenever you see two sounds together, two symbols next to each other, the one that is on the left represents the voiceless version of the sound, and the one that's on the right represents the voiced version of the sound. So again, looking at T and D, t, 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 d, 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 you can feel that buzzing with the D that you can't feel with the T. Otherwise, everything is exactly the same. The tongue's in the same position, it's being produced in the same way. The only difference between T and D is whether or not the vocal folds are vibrating, and that's called voicing. And of course, besides supersegmental features and stress, there are lots of other things that you could use to describe the speech sounds of the world's languages. And a lot of things happen in the world's languages that don't happen in English. And now that you know how English sounds work and how the IPA charts work, you can figure out what these sounds sound like and how they work just by looking at the rows and columns. So, for example, you know that a velar fricative is going to be made at the same place that you make a G in English, or a K, but instead of making it with that stop, you're going to make it with the continuous kind of airflow that you make when you make a TH or an F. So now that you know the sounds of English and you know how to use the IPA charts, you can apply this knowledge to any sound in any language that you come across, anytime that you might go a linguisting.